Hi, this is Miss Sarah, and welcome back to our third week of Instruments of the Orchestra. Today we are saying hello to the brass family, which comes after the string and the woodwind family. Now this family is a bit smaller. We're only going to be talking about four instruments today, but each one is really interesting and very different. So I hope that you enjoy learning about these instruments as much as I have learned about learning new facts about them. So first, let's go back to George's exploration of the orchestra, and this week he's going to be taking a look at the brass family, and they're going to be explaining a bit about how they work.
Next, we have the brass section. You're the noisy section.
That's right. We do make a lot of noise, but we can also play really quietly as well.
What are the brass instruments?
Well, as the name suggests, they're made of brass, and they come in all different shapes and sizes, like the ones behind us here.
How do you play your instrument?
Well, each brass instrument comes with one of these mouthpieces. You blow on it like this. And then sound comes out the end. Do you want to try? Yeah, I've got that. That's it. Good work. Do you want to hear us play it together?
Yeah.
Ready, guys?
Okay, so with that being said, that explained a little bit about how brass instruments work. So the way the vibration travels through the brass instrument is by making the buzzing noise with your lips, and that passes through the instrument. And this is something that it sounds a little funny on its own. As you could hear, it sounds a bit comical, but it translates to a really great sound. So first, today we're going to be talking about the trumpet. The trumpet makes the highest sounds of the brass family. To play the trumpet, the musician buzzes his or her lips on the funnel-shaped mouthpiece. The player can adjust their lips and press valves to change the pitch. Fun fact, if you unraveled a trumpet, it would be 6.5 feet long, which is a lot. So all that tubing, all that metal tubing, prevents it from being a big instrument. But if it was unraveled, it would be quite big. So I have an excerpt to play for you from a piece by a composer named Mussorgsky called Pictures at an Exhibition. This is a very famous trumpet solo from the very beginning of this piece. So that was a bit of that. The interesting thing about that piece, or at least the part that we listened to, is that you hear a bunch of the other brass instruments too. So while the trumpet is the solo, the other ones come in to accompany the trumpet. So the next instrument I'd like to talk about is called the French horn. The French horn makes a bit of a mellower sound than the trumpet. Now you see how it's got all of that tubing? There's a lot more. It's in a round shape. If you unraveled its metal tubing, this one would be about 12 feet long, which would be almost impossible to play. And as you can see how the cat is doing, the French horn player has to stick one of their hands in the other side in the bell of the instrument. So this is unique to the French horn. Now you might be familiar with the sound of the French horn. It's got a very unique sound. I have a piece for you to listen to from Prokofiev's Peter and the Wolf, which we're actually going to be listening to all together next time we meet. So here is the wolf's theme from Peter and the Wolf, at least a bit of it. Thank you. So that was a bit of that. I don't want you to listen to too much of it just because we're going to be listening to the entire piece and reading the entire story together next time. So I don't want to spoil you on too much of it. But that is the Wolf's theme, played by three French horns in Peter and the Wolf. The next instrument I'd like to talk to you about is called the trombone. Now the trombone, as you can see, is a little bit different than the other ones because it has a long metal slide to change pitch instead of valves or buttons on the top. It can get up to 9 feet long if the slide is all the way out, so it can be quite a big instrument. The excerpt I have for you to demonstrate the trombone is from Richard Wagner's Ride of the Valkyries. This is a really famous piece. So you probably are a bit familiar with it already. There's a bit of that solo, that excerpt featuring the trombone section. As you can hear, the trombone, at least from what I can hear, the trombone isn't quite as mellow as the French horn, but it also isn't quite as high as the trumpet. So it's kind of in between, has a unique sound. So the next instrument I want to talk about is the tuba. I also am mentioning the euphonium, which is a relative of the tuba. As you can see on the left, there is the euphonium. It's a bit smaller, and on the right is the tuba. So the tuba makes the lowest sound of the brass section. It's not the lowest instrument in the orchestra. If you remember, that would be the contrabassoon or the double bass. They can be anywhere from 9 to 18 feet long, and the bigger they are, the lower sound they make. And unlike most other instruments, there is usually only one single tuba player in the entire orchestra. That's a lot of pressure to put on one person, isn't it? So the excerpt I have for you for the tuba is from George Gershwin's An American in Paris. And this excerpt is interesting because before the music is going to play, a tuba player is going to explain a bit about the solo. So I figured I would just keep that in and let you guys hear that.
In itself, the simple four-bar solo from Gershwin's American in Paris is a tongue-in-cheek afterthought to the violin solo, which immediately precedes it, and a bridge to the coda played by the bass clarinet, which follows. To the auditioning tubist, this excerpt can be a windfall demonstration of an area which is rarely tested on the audition stage. The ability of the tuba player to shape a phrase and paint a picture, not only with virtual freedom from the ensemble, but also without having anything which is technically demanding, as for instance the high solos from either Petrushka or pictures at an exhibition. It is altogether possible, however, for the tuba player to go overboard with a solo, as is demonstrated in the second of the three versions recorded here. The player should try to demonstrate inventiveness without throwing in everything from the creative spice rack. Good taste should dictate whatever the final product is.
So that was that solo. It also explained by a tuba player. So next we're going to move on to our craft. Now that we've talked about the brass family, let's make our own trumpets. You will need a piece of construction paper, a soda bottle, scissors, masking, duct, or packaging tape, a paper towel roll, and a sharp knife. Please have an adult help you with this activity. That being said, hi. So I'm going to be making this craft along with you guys today. So just pull up my instructions so I can do this correctly. Okay, so you can find everything you need for this trumpet in your kitchen. So first of all, what I have here is a part of a soda bottle. I cut the bottom off. This is the part that you do with a knife. You want to have an adult help you with this part. So I'm going to cut a little more off. Now when you cut this, you want the cut part of the bottle to be a little larger than the width of the paper towel tube. And the bottle spout is going to be your trumpet mouthpiece. So perhaps you want it a little more than that. Keep in mind, this is my first time doing this activity as well, so I'm right with you. And then just be careful when you're cutting this plastic, as it can cut you. So just be really careful or have an adult do this for you. You really just want the top of the bottle and that's it. Let's see, so this might be good. You want it to be slightly larger, so maybe even a little more. You're really not going to use very much of this bottle at all, just the very top. It could be a little tough to cut this plastic as well, so don't get too frustrated with yourself if it doesn't go well immediately. There, I think that should be good. It's slightly wider. Well, maybe it's a little close, but it'll work. So, this is going to be our mouthpiece. Remember how we talked about how the brass instruments have mouthpieces? Mine's actually turned out a bit small, but that's okay. I could just kind of squeeze it inside. So what you want to do, once you have your bottle top, is you're going to want to tape the spout to the paper towel tube using your masking or duct tape. Personally, I just have a roll of classic duct tape. A little bit, and you want to use a bit more of a firmer tape than regular tape, just because it can be a bit tough to get this. Okay, so mine doesn't look perfect, so don't worry if yours doesn't look perfect either. What really matters is the sound that you're going to be able to make with it. So far this is what mine looks like. It's not the most gorgeous ever, but it'll hopefully work. I think the spout of the bottle being formed in the mouthpiece is interesting, because you remember what a brass mouthpiece looks like. What we ended up making with the spout of the bottle is actually not too far off from what a real one kind of looks like. If I had one with me, I would show you. They're not that different. So I've taped this, and of course it isn't perfect. But we're not going for perfection. We're just going for, we're just going for something that is functional. So don't worry if it doesn't look exactly perfect. All right, so we're going to set this aside for now and get our piece of construction paper. Since I want mine to kind of look like a brass instrument, I am using a piece of yellow construction paper, although anything works if you prefer use a different color. So what you want to do is you want to roll up paper into a funnel, like so. So take it from the corner and roll it from the corner. Kind of like this. Okay. I think perhaps it's meant to go long ways like this. Like I said, I'm doing this right alongside you, so. So you want your funnel. You want your funnel to be able to go over the other end. Of your tube here. There. Now, if you're having a hard time with this one, I don't blame you. I think that this one has been our trickiest so far, right? So here's what I have so far. Of course, you can make yours look prettier if you want, with anything you would like. So I'm getting some more tape, and I'm going to tape the piece of paper to, well, this is going to be hard to do with one hand. I'm going to tape the piece of construction paper to the paper towel roll. Don't use a toilet paper roll, just for sanitary reasons. Let me see. This is a bit hard to do with only one hand, isn't it? Don't recommend it. Or have a piece of tape cut out beforehand. Or if you're using masking tape, you can just tear that right off. There we go. Okay. So unfortunately, my funnel sort of came undone. Just have to roll it back up again. That is okay. Not going for perfection. After all, this isn't a real trumpet or anything, but wouldn't it be funny if they were made like this? All right, so you want to tape it. Tape your tube to the end of the toilet paper roll, paper towel roll. I'm going to use one more piece of duct tape. I think for this part with the paper towel roll and the paper, you could use regular tape if you want, but you know, since you've already got your other tape out, you might as well use that. Let me just tear one more piece off, and that should be all that I need. Okay, so this is an interesting little thing that I've just made. So yours might look a little better than mine. So with this in mind, we can test how this works. So buzzing, remember that buzzing is how you make noise on a brass instrument. And I'm definitely not an expert on it, as I am not a brass player. But buzzing sounds kind of silly. You kind of make like a, you kind of make like a kind of a fart noise, or like a. Let's see, how do I describe it? It's consider the way a horse does this, like, or. So what you want to do is press your lips to the inside of the tube and. So experiment, buzz your lips just right, and you'll get the right sound from the horn. This is because of the effect of sound waves. When the length of the sound wave you create matches up well with the length of the tube, the sound will get stronger. So this is not only a way to kind of have your own horn, granted you can't make that many different pitches with this particular craft, you can experiment on what carries the sound best from this end all the way out to this end. So with that being said, that wraps up my brass family exploration of the symphony orchestra. And next week, I really hope you join me. I'm going to be doing another musical story time. This time we're going to be reading the story of Peter and the Wolf. And this story implements many different members of the orchestra, including some of the brass family that we went over today. So I hope you will join me for that, and thank you for tuning in.